ideas for the environment program, and I always like to speak to humanists. I know there are a lot of scientists in this audience too, because I have interviewed some of them as my sources. But I am a humanities person to the extent that I studied anything. I studied humanities. And I have a BA in literature. I studied German literature. And I write for people who either study the humanities or have some background in the humanities, who are assumed to have sort of a liberal arts education. And The New Yorker is written for an audience that's expected to be pretty well read. If you read The New Yorker, you're never going to get like an explanation of who Jane Austen is, or who Dickens was, or who Homer or Dante or Kafka or any list, is quite long. And you're expected to be familiar not just with literature, but to have some familiarity with art, and to a certain extent with philosophy and even political thought. And you're also expected to have some currency in pop culture, right? But you are never expected to have what scientists would consider to be pretty much the most basic scientific knowledge. So the famous line, in C.P. Snow's The Two Cultures, about highly literate people not knowing the second law of thermodynamics and not particularly caring that they don't know, that definitely applies to New Yorker readers, or at least to the New Yorker's idea of its readers, right, its idealized reader. The magazine would not expect you to know the second law of thermodynamics, and it wouldn't expect you to know the first law of thermodynamics. And in fact, as those of you who are readers of the magazine know, we rarely even use numerals. We spell out numbers, so like F-I-D-E, or B-I-L-L-I-O-N. And we never use graphs. I once tried to get a chemical formula into the magazine. Maybe that would be my one claim to fame. But I failed. I couldn't get it. I don't think it's going to happen. And so the reason that there is actually even a role for someone like me, I would argue, I guess, is that the divide that Snow identified more than half a century ago now still exists, and in fact, I think some people would argue it's really only widened. So for the most part, and maybe the scientists in this room want to contradict me, but I know that one of the things I've learned today is that the whole program here designed to sort of deal with this problem is that scientists communicate with other scientists. They write for other scientists. There are some exceptions, the Steven Pinkers and the Brian Greens of the world. But for the most part, scientists write, if they're lucky, they want to get into science or nature. And they're writing, usually for magazines with titles, I have to look at my notes because I don't even remember them, Geophysical Transactions, or Plus One. And they write in language that they don't expect non-scientists to understand. They don't even expect people outside their own specialty to understand. And so that leaves all of this really important work essentially untranslated. And I think, in the introduction, I believe it was said that I translate, and that's sort of how I come to see myself as a translator, as someone who tries to take information that's written in the scientific language and translate it into language that someone like with a humanities background, which is basically someone like me, can understand. And also, and here's another challenge, something that they would actually want to read. And I saw myself described in one of the press releases about this event as a poet of catastrophe. And I really, really like that phrase, I have to say. But it's really way too grand. I'm really just a translator of catastrophe, which unfortunately sounds less poetic, I guess. So I try to take, the contents of geophysical transaction and turn that into narrative. And that can be a tough slog. But most of the time I do that with scientists who are studying human impacts on the planet. And the reason for this is, pretty basic. It's because I think it's very important information for people to have. And you could argue that it really ultimately doesn't matter that much whether people know what the second law of thermodynamics is. Entropy is always going to be increasing, whether we realize it or not. But it does matter if people don't understand the impacts that they themselves, or we ourselves, are having. And that is what I'm going to talk about today. about what science tells us about the ways in which you and I, and really everyone, virtually everyone on the planet today, are changing the planet, and about what this means for ourselves and for our kids and for other species on the planet, and also really for what it means for our understanding of what it means to be a human being. And I know, I just want to say as one little aside, I know people are coming at this talk from very different backgrounds, some humanists, some scientists, so I apologize to the scientists if some of this is really basic stuff. But anyway, I call my talk today Welcome to the Anthropocene. I also consider calling it Man in the Anthropocene, which, as many of you humanists, I'm sure, recognize, is a play on the title of a Max Frisch novella, Man in the Holocene, which, as it happens, was actually first published in translation in the New Yorker in 1980. So officially, we live in the Holocene, which means the wholly recent epoch. And this is a representation of the geological timescale. And the thing that's important to realize about this is that it's not at all drawn to scale. Okay, so what you're seeing on the right there, under the Precambrian, that is all of Earth history until we get a sophisticated multicellular life 500 million years ago. So that's about 4 billion years of Earth history. And then we get to the Paleozoic, which lasted for about 200, 300 million years. And then we get to the Mesozoic, which lasted for about 190 million years. And then we get to the Cenozoic, which lasted, which is since the dinosaurs left us, about 66 million years ago. And now you see that tiny little thing, it's not even really visible there, that tiny little thing at the end, that is the Holocene. And I am here, I'm blowing up the Cenozoic, that yellow, the geological timescale is done in a wonderful color code, so it's still yellow. And you see that the Cenozoic is divided into all these different epochs. And once again, it's still not drawn to scale, because the Pleistocene, it started about 2.5 million years ago. And that was this period when we began to go into a time of recurrent ice ages. And toward the end of the Pleistocene, about 200,000 years ago, that is when anatomically modern humans appear on the scene. And so at the very top is the Holocene. It should be much narrower. This is done so that you can, they could actually squeeze the letters in. That's about the last 11,700 years ago. It's the period since the last glaciation. And the Holocene really is the period that represents the world as we know it. 11,700 years ago, most of New York was buried under ice, and Long Island didn't really exist. Long Island was, to a large extent, as we probably know this, created by the last ice age and by the melt from these enormous glaciers that extended just about this far south. And the melt front was right around here, and as these glaciers retreated around 11,700 years ago, they left behind a lot of debris. And that debris is Long Island. I probably didn't put that down. And when the ice sheets melted, the glaciers melted, we got a tremendous sea level rise at several hundred feet, and the coastlines took on sort of more or less their current configuration. And it turns out that the Holocene, this is something that has only been discovered very recently by looking at ice cores from Greenland, was a time of unusual climate stability. And it's been during this period, probably not coincidentally, when agriculture was invented, right? Except humans actually appeared 200,000 years ago, but we don't get agriculture until about 9,000 years ago, when people began to settle down and build villages and cities, when written languages developed. So basically everything that we associate with human civilization happened during the Holocene. And now there's this very serious question, have we entered a new epoch, which has already been given a name, as I said, the Anthropocene. So the human, are we changing the planet in such profound ways that we've entered a new geological time? And the term is a neologism. It's pronounced many different ways. I've probably pronounced it several different ways already today. The British tend to call it the Anthropocene. Americans tend to call it the Anthropocene. And it was introduced about a decade ago by Paul Crutzen, who is a Dutch chemist who shared the Nobel Prize for helping to discover ozone-depleting chemicals. And he wrote this little essay, which appeared in Nature in 2002. So that's the whole thing. It was very short. And the idea really just sort of took off. It was one of those ideas that seems to have just been waiting for someone to articulate it. So now there are whole journals devoted to the Anthropocene, the Anthropocene Review, the Anthropocene. I think there's another one. These are academic journals. There's a cover story in The Economist. You can see Royal Philosophical Transactions A devoted an issue to the question, are we in the Anthropocene? GSA Today, which is a publication from the Geological Society of America. So a piece of National Geographic, which I actually wrote. So you get the idea. And while there's still a lot of formal debate on this issue, there's in fact an Anthropocene working group of the International Commission on Stratigraphy that is looking at the question of should we formally designate this new epoch. In an informal sense, I think there's a fair amount of consensus among scientists who study this sort of thing that we have indeed entered a new time that's going to be defined by our impact on the world, and it's going to have its lasting effects that the geologists of the distant future, whoever and whatever they are still going to be able to see many, many millions of years from now. And there are a lot of ways you could look at this and a lot of ways you could demonstrate our impact. You could look at land use changes, for example, how much of the surface of the Earth we've just transformed by building cities, by building roads, by industrial scale agriculture, right? All of those are going to leave signatures behind. You could look at hydrology, how we've changed the flow of major rivers. Most of the world's major rivers today are dammed or diverted, and that has a huge effect on sedimentation. It changes the way deltas are formed. Also, that signal will be legible basically forever. But I'm going to focus on three ways that we're changing the world this afternoon, because they seem to me to be most significant. Other people might have different views on this. It's how we're changing the atmosphere, how we're changing the oceans, and how we're changing the course of evolution. So let's look at the atmosphere. Every year, in fact, just the other day, some of you may have read, we got the latest figures from something called the Global Carbon Project on the latest figures on carbon emissions. They were 36 billion tons, I think, for 2011. I mean, it's 2012. I'm not sure how up-to-date they are. That we added 36 billion metric tons of carbon dioxide to the atmosphere. So that is coming, for the most part, from burning fossil fuels. You all know this, so I'm not going to belabor it. It's really ordinary stuff. We drive our cars. We turn on our lights. There are 7.2 billion of us on the planet right now, and it pretty quickly adds up. And what we are doing when we are taking, when we burn fossil fuels, is that we are taking carbon that was buried under the Earth over the course of hundreds of millions of years, and we are just transferring it back into the atmosphere. So we are basically running geological history backwards, and we're doing it at very high speed, right? So we're taking this process that took hundreds of millions of years to run in one direction, and we're running it in the other direction in a couple of centuries. And if you were an alien and you came to visit the Earth, you could easily conclude that what we are doing, that the primary purpose of modern society is to effect this transfer as quickly as possible, to see how much carbon we can get out of the ground and how fast we can put it up into the air. And if the aliens were measuring this process, and of course we are measuring this process, they'd see that we are doing quite a good job, that we are increasing atmospheric CO2 levels every year. So this is a graph that I'm sure you've all seen. It's called the Keeling Curve. Named after the guy who first figured out how to measure CO2 levels in the atmosphere very precisely, a guy named Charles David Keeling, who unfortunately died a few years ago. And these measurements are taken on Mauna Loa, on the flank of Mauna Loa, which is this huge volcanic mountain on the island of Hawaii. And they've been taken continuously since 1958, you can see. And that sawtooth pattern that you're seeing there is the seasonal component to CO2 measurements. So in the summer, when the trees in the northern hemisphere put out their leaves and start photosynthesizing, they take in CO2, and global CO2 levels drop. We just have more forests and more land in the northern hemisphere. And when these trees drop their leaves, then global CO2 levels go up again. And you may have read recently that CO2 levels hit 400 parts per million, that green line there. And that is true, they did. But they have since fallen back. We're around 394 right now. That's a very, very recent reading from Mauna Loa. But they're going to keep going up in this sawtooth pattern-like way until eventually, in the next couple of years, they're going to get to a point where they never go below 400 parts per million. And they're just going to keep going up, marching up like that, at the rate of roughly 2 parts per million, because we definitely don't show any signs stopping emitting CO2. On the contrary, as I said, we are increasing it pretty rapidly. So if we want to see how we've been doing on this project, we want to take a longer view of this, like how does this compare in geological time. We are actually very fortunate we can do that now because of our quite brilliant science, which has figured out how to extract CO2 data from ice cores. So what you're looking at here is the data from a very famous core called the Vostok core, which was taken on Antarctica. And what you're looking at here is 400,000, that's 400,000 years ago, going up to the present, so time moving left to right. You're looking at 4 glacial cycles there, so 4 times when the ice sheets came down, roughly to Long Island, and then retreated again. And you see how CO2 levels rise and fall. They fall during an ice age, and they rise up again to around 280 parts per million during an interglacial. And you see that for the last 400,000 years, it says 650,000 years there, and that is true. We have actually extended the record back to 800,000 years. CO2 levels have never been above that line, which stands for 300 parts per million, until now. And now they're going up basically in a straight line. And when what peak scientists do when they look at an ice core, they can literally extract bubbles of air from that ice. So they are literally getting a sample of past atmospheres. And if we want to look even further back, we can do that too. We don't have ice that's that old, but we can tease out this information from other sources, sort of proxy sources, shells of marine organisms that incorporated carbon into their shells, things like that. And so this is a graph that appeared in Science a couple years ago. We're looking at CO2 levels now. Time's moving in the other direction, so the present is at zero. We're moving back, and now we're in millions of years. We're looking at almost 50 million years here. The only reason I'm showing you this graph is because you see that CO2 has been pretty low, like around 300 parts per million, where that orangey line is, basically since the beginning of the Miocene, so for about the last 20 million years. And if you want to go above 500 parts per million, where we will be getting within the next 30 years or so on our current rate, you've got to go all the way back to the Oligocene, so around 25 or 30 million years ago. And you know that people, sometimes play this game, what would it have been like, what period would you like to have lived in? Would you like to have lived in Elizabethan England or Greece or Rome or something? Well, we are sort of playing this game now, and we're saying, what was it like to live in the Oligocene? Because we are going to be recreating the climate of the Oligocene. So what's significant about this, as you all know, is that CO2 has certain basic properties that make it a greenhouse gas. I'm not going to give you that whole spiel, because I'm sure you know it, and it's very basic geophysics. CO2 traps heat infrared radiation near the surface of the Earth. And the one thing that's maybe interesting about this from a humanist point of view is that this has been understood for a very long time. This is a wonderful machine called a spectrophotometer. And this print is actually from Philosophical Transactions from like 1860. And this machine was built in 1859 by a British scientist named John Tyndall. And Tyndall was one of those great, you know, English polymaths of the 19th century. He was interested in everything. He was interested in optics. He was interested in acoustics. He was interested in glaciology. You name it. And he was, unfortunately, a terrible insomnia. And he ultimately died of an overdose of an early sleeping drug, administered, I should add, by his wife. So he designed this machine because he wanted to look at the properties of different gases. And what he found, he realized right away, was extremely significant for our climate. So he tested the gases that are most prevalent in our atmosphere, which are oxygen and nitrogen, and he discovered that they're transparent throughout the spectrum. Okay, so they're transparent to visible light, they let in visible light, which is what we get from the sun, and they let out infrared radiation, which is what we, what the planet is re-radiating out to space. And so this is a bit counterintuitive, but it is kind of crucial to understand what's going on. So I'll just show this little schematic, right? We are getting in energy all the time from the sun in the form of visible light, and we are re-radiating it out to space in the form of infrared radiation or heat. And those two energy streams have to balance out. Some of it gets bounced off the clouds, but most of it enters our atmosphere, you can see Earth. And we are not now in balance. Those two energy streams are not in balance. That is one of our big problems. But eventually they're going to rebalance themselves because that's just sort of basic physics. And Tyndall understood that, and when he tested CO2, he got a different result. He realized that CO2 was transparent in the visible part of the spectrum, but it was partly opaque in the infrared. So it let light in, but does not let all the heat back out. And he realized that that sort of blocking action was crucial, and it was crucial to life on Earth. It's what prevents the Earth from being not just a frozen ball. CO2 and other greenhouse gases in our atmosphere. So that effect is often called the natural greenhouse effect. You've probably heard that phrase. And it's been understood for a century and a half now. So there's really no news here. And if you understand that CO2 is a heat-trapping gas, and you know that we're rapidly raising CO2 level in the atmosphere, then you would expect, all things being equal, you would expect average global temperatures to be going up. And that is indeed, as you know, exactly what's happening. And this next slide I'm going to show is not a slide, it's a little video. And what you have to know to understand it is that as the colors get warmer, sort of redder and orangier, that's warmer temperatures, and as they get bluer, that's colder temperatures. And that this video was prepared by NASA. So these are NASA data using the instrumental temperature record, which only goes back to around the 1880s. So that's where we're going to start in the 1880s. Okay, here we go. The history of the planet in about a minute. Unfortunately, it runs out in 2011, the updated version, but it would not look very different. So, you know, when you warm up the planet like that, it has some pretty big knock-on effects, as you know. And this list is really, I don't want to say endless, but it's a very long list, so I'm just going to mention some of the highlights of what is happening, what we're doing. As you know, we're melting the Arctic ice cap. This slide shows you what the Arctic ice cap looked at. Okay, so what's important to realize here, sorry, I have to take a step back, is like CO2 levels, the ice cap has a seasonal component. It gets smaller in the summer when you get 24-hour sunlight up at the North Pole, and it grows again during the winter when the sun really never rises above the Arctic Circle. So, what we're interested in is the perennial ice cap, the ice cap that's there summer and winter, and we take that at the end of the summer, at the end of the summer melt season. And this last year, it ended about 2 months ago. It was declared over. It started to grow again on September 19th, 2011. 2013. And so what you're looking at, imagine you're in a little hovercraft above the North Pole, you're just looking down at the top of the Earth, and where you see that orange line, that's sort of the recent, not even the long term, but the recent average of where the ice cap used to be, and then you're seeing where it actually was at the end of the 2013 melt season. And you can see that there's a northeast passage open. You may have read about the Russians sort of trying to claim all this stuff in the Arctic as a shipping lane, and there's a lot of oil up there. So that's going to be an interesting point of geopolitical tension. There was almost a northwest passage open. I'm sure everyone here has read some of the wonderful tales of people who miserably lost their lives searching for a northwest passage. You can see it's always very complicated to get through a northwest passage. But it is now doable. Last summer was a record melt. This is the same image from satellite imagery at the end of last summer. You can see how tiny the ice cap was. It was the lowest in recorded history. And there was a northwest passage open, so you could obtain it both in the northwest passage. Only Franklin had been alive today. So to give you just another example, we're changing where it rains and we're changing how it rains. So more rain is falling in these tremendous downpours. That's a pretty well-established phenomenon. This is recent flooding in Colorado that I'm sure you read about. I don't need to tell people here about Sandy. And here, of course, we have the recent typhoon in the Philippines. So as far as humans are concerned, these sorts of changes are probably how we're going to experience the effects of this planetary re-engineering most immediately and just probably soonest. We're going to see it in rainfall, we're going to see it in rising sea levels, and increasingly damaging storms. But global warming is not the only effect of CO2 emissions. They have another very large effect, even more significant in geological terms. And that's what's happening to the oceans. So this is the phenomenon known as ocean acidification. This is how I once tried to get a chemical formula into the mirror and failed. And the phenomenon is actually slightly complicated, and I'm not going to sort of go through the actual chemistry of it, but there are only a few basic things you need to know. The oceans have absorbed about a third of the CO2 we put up there since the start of the Industrial Revolution. That's about 150 billion metric tons. I know that doesn't mean much, but it's a very big number. Every 4 hours, the seas absorb another million metric tons of CO2. And the net result is that the acidity of the ocean has already increased by 30%. So, when you dissolve CO2 in water, you get something called carbonic acid. We drink carbonic acid all the time, right? Whenever you have a glass of seltzer or glass of any soda, you're drinking carbonic acid. It's a very weak acid, but it is an acid. And when you pour 150 billion metric tons of CO2 into the water, you do measurably change its chemistry. So acidification affects a lot of different properties of the water. But one of the key things that it does is it makes it harder, or at least more energetically demanding, for all of these organisms that build shells or external skeletons out of the mineral calcium carbonate. And to use an analogy, because that's what humanists often do, it becomes like trying to build a house, let's use this analogy, when someone's stealing your bricks. It just becomes harder and harder to assemble the materials that these organisms need to assemble their homes. And if you have a shell or a piece of pearl at home, you can do this experiment. It's very simple. You take it and you throw it in a bowl of vinegar, and it's going to start to bubble and it's going to start to dissolve. And everyone basically knows that and understands that. But long before you can actually get calcium carbonate to dissolve, you're making it harder and harder to put it together in the first place. So here are some examples of calcifying organisms. Those are coccolithophores. They're being shown at very high magnification there. They're really, really tiny. They make these little calcitic plates for themselves, this sort of armor. And they're one-celled organisms. They're so prolific that sometimes of year they form these huge blooms that form these so that they turn really large sections of the seas into this sort of milky white color. Those are calcifiers, very ordinary, shellfish, clams, oysters, and mussels are calcifiers. Sea urchins are calcifiers, those spiny things in their home, their test, as it's called. That's all made out of calcium chlorate. Starfish are calcifiers. That is a kind of a really beautiful blue starfish you see on the Great Barrier Reef. And corals. When they form a coral reef, they are forming an external skeleton out of calcium carbonate. They're very, very key calcifiers. So people, organisms do have to deal with changing conditions. They have to deal with changing pH conditions on a daily and on a seasonal basis. So they do have some flexibility and obviously some ability to deal with that. But the question of as we acidify the oceans, as we take the pH of the water down, what's going to happen is a really significant one. Many, many people are working on that now, trying to figure out what the ocean of the future is going to look like. The more CO2 we put into the air, the more we're going to put into the oceans. So here is a sort of a natural experiment that I visited a couple of years ago. And I was fortunate enough to visit it with a National Geographic photographer. So here we are off the coast of Ischia. We are underwater. This is in the Bay of Naples, and the pH of the water that you're looking at here is around 8.1. So that's relatively normal. It's already been taken down somewhat by the CO2 that we've already poured into the atmosphere, but this is what you see underwater there if you were scuba diving right in this area, a pretty rich collection of organisms. Now, in this area, we have a lot of volcanic activity, and it turns out there are these vents are just shooting CO2 into the water. So this is like a naturally acidified area of the Mediterranean, and it's a really interesting little lab. Okay, so what does it look like when we acidify the water? What happens to these organisms? So now we're going to look at, we're going to be looking at the next slide is an area where the pH is around 7.8. And what I need to explain to you, what's a crucial piece of information here, is that if we continue on our merry way for the rest of the century, we will bring the pH of the water down to 7.8. Okay, that would be where we're going to end up by the end of the century, and it will just keep going down if we continue on. So when we look at what happens when we pull the pH down to 7.8, this is those vents I was talking about that send these bubbles of CO2 into the water. It's very beautiful when you're underwater. It looks like like quicksilver, that you're swimming in these beads of quicksilver. It looks like the moon, right? There is practically nothing left that can survive. So that is a natural sort of experiment where you look into the future and say, okay, what does it look like if you bring the pH of the oceans down to 7.8? And I think we can all agree it doesn't look too good. So here is another place that I went to look at this phenomenon, or look at people looking at this phenomenon. How's that? This is Heron Island. You're seeing it from the air here. It's in the Great Barrier Reef. It's like a lot of all the islands in the Great Barrier Reef, really, which are most of them, which are formed right out of the reef. They're just little bits of the reef that stick above all the waves. And you see it's all surrounded by reef there. And what scientists there were doing was they were taking corals, which are pretty adaptable, and they'll let you just take them out of the water and glue them to a little tile, and you can raise them in these tanks, and they're bubbling in CO2 to look at different effects on different stages of their life and different levels of CO2. And so they were looking at what happens when the corals reproduce, when they form larvae, and the larvae then drop out of the water column. They have to adhere to other coral and start their own sort of colony. I mean, they were finding significant effects at every stage of development when you have high CO2 water. And there's studies, and similar studies have been done, you know, on reefs around the world, suggest that if we keep on our current emissions path, then by around the middle of this century, corals are just not going to be able to keep up. Okay, they're not going to calcify fast enough to keep creating reefs fast enough so that the other forces that are trying to undermine reefs, which are creatures that are eating away at the reef, and also just wave action, which is very has a big impact on reefs and sort of erodes them, obviously. They're just not going to be able to keep up with that, and they're going to start to disintegrate. So, you know, I said that my job is a translator, but this is a quote from a paper in Science a couple years ago. It doesn't really need any translation. It's saying that if we continue on this emissions path, then by around the middle of the century, reefs are going to become rapidly eroding bubble banks. So these are two ways that we're changing the planet. They're obviously related. We are pouring CO2 into the atmosphere, and without our intending to, a lot of the CO2 is ending up in the oceans. And one more thing that's important to mention is to get back to this question of the speed and the rate at which we're doing all this, is that over the normal course of geological history, there have been times when CO2 levels in the atmosphere were higher than they are now. And we did have reefs at those times. But the important thing to realize is that we are doing this so fast that these other sort of geological processes that would buffer acidification, that would come into place or counteract what we're doing, just don't have time. They don't have time to keep up. Those are forces that act on the millennial scale, and we are doing this, you know, in a matter of a couple of decades. So if you look back at geological history, it turns out that what we're doing is really, really unusual. You know, normally you think that if we look at the broad expanse of history, then to paraphrase Humphrey Bogart, the actions of people, you know, don't amount to a hill of beans in this crazy world. But it turns out that here we have the opposite effect. If we look at what we were doing in the broadest possible context, it becomes more significant, potentially unprecedented. You have this phrase now in the scientific literature that we are in a no analog world. So here's another quote. Again, it doesn't need any translation. Business as usual is likely to leave a legacy of the Anthropocene as one of the most notable, if not cataclysmic, events in the history of our planet. This is from a recent paper, pretty recent paper, looking back at ocean acidification over geological, in the context of geological. So the third thing I said I was going to talk about, the last thing, was our impact on other species. This is really what the subject of the book that I have just written is. So here, what you're looking at is extinction rates. I'm trying to graphically represent extinction rates. And in the first column on your left, in the purple, we're looking at the fossil record, and we're saying how often should we be able to see an animal go extinct? So one column is marine species, another column is mammals. And you're seeing that the basic rate is for every 1,000 mammal species, fewer than one going extinct every millennium. Now we go into the recent past. We up that by two orders of magnitude, okay? And now we're looking at the future model projections, and we're upping it again by another two orders of magnitude. So if you look back at the record, at the fossil record, what it suggests to you is that if you're a person and you live for, you know, a lifespan of, let's say, you know, 3 score and 10, then to the first approximation, you should not be able to see a mammal species go extinct. Zero. No mammals should be going extinct. but if you think about what you know, and you think about, you look at, you know, the recent past, what we know about mammal extinctions, then we probably, everyone in this room, you know, can probably think of one species of mammal that they've heard about either going extinct recently, or really hovering right on the edge of extinction. And if you can't, I will provide one. This is the Yangtze River dolphin that was declared extinct in 2006. It used to be a pretty common site on the Yangtze River, and scientists went out and looked for the, tried to find, it had become very rare. They tried to see if they could find a single one, and they couldn't. So that is, animal is almost certainly gone. So we become kind of inured to extinction. We think of one or two extinctions as not a big deal, but what that fossil record shows us is that if you can see an extinction in your lifetime, something very, very unusual is going on. It's a process that, I'm sorry to say, you can watch happening right here in New York. I'm sure you all recognize this fellow. He is a little brown bat. He's afflicted with what's called white nose syndrome, which is a fungus. I'm sure you've all heard about it. It's a cold-loving fungus, and it kills bats by interrupting their hibernation. So bats go into hibernation right around this time of year, in caves and in mine shafts, things like that. Their body temperature drops, their immune system shuts down, and they just hang there, basically immobile, all winter long. And when they get infected by this fungus, which is fine not just on their noses, but all over, it somehow irritates them, wakes them up. No one's exactly sure how. They fly out of their hibernacula, and there's no food at that time, this time of year, for them, and so they drop dead in quite horrifying numbers. Millions and millions of bats in the Northeast drop dead. I went to visit a cave in Vermont where you could literally, you couldn't walk. There was just a carpet several inches thick of dead bats. And if you go back now to that same cave, which I have done, it's just this sort of muck on the floor of the cave, and these tiny toothpick-like, a whole carpet, these toothpick-like bat bones. And that event, this extinction event, is centered in upstate New York. It was first discovered, the fungus first showed up right outside of Albany, and it has spread in all directions ever since. It's now in, I think the latest count is 22 states and 5 Canadian provinces. And what this story tells us, what White Nose story tells us, which I think is extremely sobering, is you don't need to deliberately kill animals. You don't even need to destroy their habitat to do a tremendous amount of damage. So just in the very ordinary course of events, what we consider very ordinary course of events, traveling around by air and by sea, we're wreaking a lot of havoc. Because we're bringing together these evolutionary lineages that have been separated for many, many millions of years. So this fungus probably is from Europe. It's been traced back to Europe. It was probably brought across completely unwittingly by someone to a cave in upstate New York. In fact, the first place that it's documented was actually in Howe's Caverns, which is many of you probably been into even. Big, big tourist attraction. It gets about 200,000 visitors a year. So someone probably brought it over. But when you bring species together that have been separated by an ocean, you know, for millions and millions of years, a lot of time nothing is going to happen, but every once in a while something very bad is going to happen. And that something very bad is clearly happening with white nose. So the little brown bat is a really, really numerous species. There are millions and millions of little brown bats all across the U.S., and I don't think that most wildlife biologists expect them actually to go extinct. But they may well become locally extinct. The little brown bat, which is the most common bat in Vermont, is now listed on the endangered species list in that state. And they may also become functionally extinct, right? They're not going to play the same role in the ecosystem when you only have a few of them than they did when you had millions and millions of them. And that may have knock-on effects that we just can't anticipate. And then there are other bat species that were already in trouble, a species called the Indiana bat, for example, that was on the federal endangered species list before white nose hit, that may actually go extinct because of this syndrome. So here's another example of a species that's being devastated by an introduced species. And I'm showing you this one. This part of the presentation could go on and on, but this is the last one I'm going to show you, and I'm showing him to you or her. It's a mangrove finch. It's from the Galapagos. It's one of the finches that Darwin collected, which helped him come up with his theory of natural selection. This species is now critically endangered. It's down to its last 60 birds living in very, very remote parts of the Wild West. And here the problem is an introduced fly. It's a little parasitic fly that was probably introduced from cargo from South America. So this is the one slide I'm going to show you that's really gross. This is what the fly does to these little fledgling birds. It eats away at its little larvae, take up residence in the bird's nasal cavities, eat through the beak. And even if the bird survives, it's going to have a deformed beak, which is really quite, you know, suggestive and ironic given the theory of natural selection and how much it depended on Darwin's noticing that these different finches had different beaks that let them do different kinds of jobs. So even if the chick survives, it's probably not going to last very long, it's probably not going to survive to reproduce. So you could say, here, we'll go outside for a moment. So you might say, you know, what's the big deal? Oh, we're missing some mammals. We're missing some birds, we're missing some corals. There's a lot of species out there, many millions. We don't even know how many million species that there are out there, and all of that is absolutely true. And I don't necessarily see this as affecting human life, the fabric of human life, but it does change the fabric of life itself. So we're cutting off these paths of evolution, and that effect is permanent. That's one of the lessons that we learned from Darwin. There's no going back. Once you lost the dinosaurs, you never get them back. And if you wipe out the great apes, the non-human great apes, the orangutans, and the chimps and the gorillas, which are all critically endangered, then you don't get them back. And the more extinctions we cause, obviously the greater that impact is going to be. So meanwhile, the future inhabitants of the planet, right, are going to be whatever we allow or enable to survive. So I was out recently with the guy. I mentioned that there was this working group that's looking to see whether the Anthropocene should be designated formally. There's a guy, a British geologist, who's in charge of that effort. And he pointed out to me that people have brought rats everywhere. Everywhere we've gone, we've brought with us rats. So there are now rats in places even that have no native roads. There are rats in places that people never settled. They just arrived there, they let their rats off. The rats did wonderfully, the people left. So this is a rat, a Pacific rat. He's enjoying him or herself somewhere in Hawaii. Pacific rats came with early Polynesian settlers to Hawaii. They fly on some of the first boats that ever got to Hawaii. They're all over now. Rats are obviously very adaptable. They're the beneficiaries of human disturbances. And one of the effects, evolutionary effects that we know can happen quite rapidly, especially on islands, is giantism. So by this guy's account, what I was mentioning, this British geologist, and it seems if it's not, you don't find it entirely plausible, it's certainly provocative, how's this, is that one of the lasting human legacies is that we're going to leave behind a world populated by giant rats. So this brings me back, finally, to the humanities. These changes that I've been talking about are, I think, the great stories of our time, and I don't mean great in the sense of wonderful, I mean great in the sense of huge. They're events of such significance that it would really be impossible to exaggerate it. They're not easy to write about, and that's a challenge, that I have struggled with, how to make this information accessible to people and make them actually interested in reading about it. But these events and this science raises questions that I think are really central to what the humanities are all about. How should we think about ourselves? What does it mean to be human? And I really think we have to understand ourselves in new ways.